I would like for it to be a very enjoyable and fun experience for all of you. I'm not too worried about whether you get it or you don't get it. We're going to have a good time today. We're going to explore something that I think is very interesting to every one of us, and that is ourself. And my guess is it rates high on our interest level. Okay? And we're going to be exploring the self, we're going to be studying the self, and we're going to be doing that, in my mind, for a particular reason. And that reason or direction is that what I would really like is for you, by the end of this 3 or 3.5 hour session, that you have a direct experience of transcending yourself, of going beyond yourself. Now, historically, Zen training has been all about this. In fact, one of the most famous and greatest of the Zen teachers, he's actually what we would call the founder of the Soto School of Zen, which I am a member of, his name was Dogen Zenji, said that to study the way, or the Buddha way, as he put it, is to study the self, and to study the self is to forget the self, or to transcend the self. And to forget the self is to be awakened by the 10,000 dharmas, or 10,000 things. And that means that there is an intimate connection with all things. And that's what we're going to be moving towards during these 3 hours, so that you actually have an experience of these three levels. Okay? Now, historically, this has only been possible in rare cases and after long, long periods of sitting in zazen or sitting in meditation, usually in a monastery, sometimes off in the wilderness, forests or deserts or so forth. My own experience came before I ever started any kind of traditional practice. It was while I was out in the desert with some friends and actually hiked on alone, went up to a mountain and was sitting there contemplating how in the world I could screw up my life so badly at the age of 26. I'd already been divorced. I was finding myself in a new relationship with the same old problems. And I couldn't believe that I could find another person who brought up the same issues. Of course, only to realize that it all had to do with me and nothing to do with the other, or very little. As I said, this experience normally would be pursued between a teacher and a student, and very often one-on-one. And the teacher would try to use what we would call a turning word, or maybe the use of what we call a katz, which is a shout, or maybe the use of a stick, which we call kyosaku, maybe the use of words. And by some chance, when a person was ripe, when a person was well prepared and ready for an experience, then with the right turning word, and it could be an action as well as a word, with the right turning word, there would be an awakened experience. Let me say this. Our pets, our dogs, do this better than we do, and that is that, like with my dog, when she has something in her mouth, like a bone, and I want to give her a treat, she knows enough to drop the bone, right, in order to pick up the treat. All right, we don't learn as readily, as quickly. So what we try to do, and it's all of our tendency, you don't have to think you're the Lone Ranger, we all hold on or cling to whatever insights or whatever experiences we have had, hoping now to add a new insight or a new experience to the old one. Or we try to repeat the old experiences Because we forget what Heraclitus said, that you cannot step into the same river twice. You're not going to have the exact same experience two times. Every experience is new. Every experience is in the moment. So by clinging to the old experience, what that does is it prevents us from going further or having a new genuine experience. So we have to somehow let go of the old to pick up the new, okay? So even if you know a lot about Zen or Buddhism, or you've done a lot of Western therapy, psychology, Gestalt, or whatever, what I'm gonna ask is that you come to this workshop, come in with a beginner's mind. Try to forget about what you know already and just be open and receptive to what you can discover or experience today. And one of the reasons that this process, and I've only discovered it just a little over 6 years ago, in June of 1999, I had been exploring since 1971 for ways to bring people to an awakened experience, an enlightened experience. And I studied from 1972 until the death of my teacher in 1994, was it 94 or 95? 95, to his death. I studied and was practicing and working with people how to bring about what we call Kensho experience. Kensho means an experience of seeing into our true nature. In 1999, I discovered this process. And I want to let you know why this works, because I want you to be able to use it in your daily life so that it has meaning for you in your work, in your careers, in your relationships, and in your spiritual practice. Okay? Now, one thing that I want to say is whatever experience that you have today, whatever insight, that insight will only be deepened if you practice meditation. You will deepen it by practicing and by practicing this method. Those two things will deepen it. The way that you embody it is, again, through meditation. So if you do this workshop and you have a great experience and you don't do anything further, what will happen is it'll just become a found memory. That's all. So I just want to let you know that, because it will be a turning experience. But without further sitting, it'll just become an experience that you had. Now, for me, I was very fortunate that I mentioned that experience I had in the desert. The people I was with, he was an old high school friend who had just gotten his PhD in Western psychology, and he had studied a little Zen. And he mentioned to me, it sounds like the experience you just had was a Zen experience. And he gave me a book called Siddhartha by Hermann Hesse. And I read that book and I began sitting that very day. And I am very grateful for that, that he turned me on to Zen and that I began sitting, because otherwise that experience, which turned out to transform my life and be the direction of my entire life after that, would have been just a memory had I not been sitting. So I just want to let you know on that. So some of the things that allow this to work for you and that you should know. One is that in traditional Zen training, there is a lot of hitting and shouting. And this tends to have an effect on our ego. Okay? And we as Westerners don't really like to be shouted at. And we don't really like being hit with a stick. It's just the way we are. And we don't like to be ordered around. Now, when I first came to the Zen Center, which was 1 year after that experience in 1972, the session, and that's S-E-S-S-H-I-N, session, was with what was to become my teacher's teacher, and his name was Koriroshi. And Koriroshi was a Rinzai Zen master, a layman, not a monk, and he would go up and down the Zendo shouting at us, "Dai Anyo Zafu!" kill yourself in Zazen. Drop off body mind. And of course, we'd be going, or at least I would, sure. I am going to kill myself right here on my cushion. I'm going to drop body and mind right here. I'm going to die in this moment. No way. So what that did for us Westerners was bring up resistance. Okay? Now, resistance is something to work with, but if there's too much resistance, what we create is a conflict and eventually a war with ourselves. Why this method is so successful is that it is non-threatening. It is non-intimidating. I am not going to fight with your egos because I'll lose. I know that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to hire or enlist your egos to work for me. I'm going to ask, and I'm going to use the magic word, which us as Westerners have all been taught by our mommies, opens all the doors, and I'm going to use the magic word, please. If somebody orders you, like, get me a cup of coffee now, we might do it under the right circumstances. It's a boss, right? All right. But under our breath, we're cussing them out. You know, we're saying, I wasn't hired to bring you cups of coffee, right? We feel belittled. We feel somehow that's beneath us. But if the same situation occurs and that same boss says, would you mind, would you please get me a cup of coffee? I could really use one. I'm falling asleep here and I'd like to be more awake. We will jump to it because we love to serve. That's one of our characteristics as Westerners. We love to serve, but we don't like having it demanded of us. We're glad to do it if somebody asks in the proper way. So what I'll be doing during this period of time and working with you, and what you need to know in working with yourself, is somehow you have to also get around your own ego. Because it's the ego or the self that stands in the way and obstructs you from opening vistas, opening doors, and opening areas of your mind and your life that you could not have ever dreamt were possible. The ego is there as a guard and a guardian, and it's preventing you from doing that because when you do that, there is no ego. And the last thing the ego wants to do is not be present. It has no clue what goes on when it's not present, and it doesn't like the very thought of it not being present. So what we'll do is invite the ego to support us, but never force it to go very far away. We will always allow the ego to be right there. It can even witness the whole thing. It just needs to relinquish control. Now, even that scares the ego. This, the thought of relinquishing control, can bring up fear. So we will do it in a way that the ego always has freedom of choice. So what I want to say is no one here has to participate. This is free to join in or to sit back and just observe. Nobody is going to be forced to go into anything or beyond anything that one does not want to go. Okay? The other thing is that if you play along, if you do the game, because it is a game, and you're in there and fear comes up or resistance comes up, I invite you to allow the ego to take control again. Okay? Now, all of the responsibility of getting this, I'm putting on your hands. Okay? If you're not staying up, just let me know. And you can let me know in any number of ways. You can stand up, you can wave your arms, you can wink, you can do anything that you need to signal me that somehow you're falling behind, you're not keeping up with the group. Because what I like to do is to make sure that 100% of us do the whole thing, stay on the same page, and get there if you choose to. Okay? If you choose not to, that's fine. That's your choice. I will not be, my feelings will not be hurt. You know, it may not be the right time for you, may not be the right day for you. That's fine. We'll do it another time or maybe another lifetime. Okay? What we're going to do is we're going to dissect the self today. Now, there's a reason to dissect something, and that is to learn more about it. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to dissect the self in order to learn more about the self. Okay? Now, hopefully, if we don't run out of time, we'll put it back together before the end of the day. But if we run out of time, it's Humpty Dumpty time, which is not such a bad thing. No, so we will dissect the self in order to study the self, in order to transcend the self. Okay? So that's what we're going to be doing. Now, have any of you thought about questions such as, who am I? Or what is my true self? Or what is my true nature? I'm seeing a lot of bobbing heads. Yes. What we're going to do is we're going to be looking at that today. And we're going to be discovering why it is so difficult somehow to grasp that. Why it's so difficult to put our hands or fingers on who I really am. We can all come up with what I do. You know, I'm a mother, I'm a father, I'm a grandparent, I'm a son, I'm a daughter, I work in this field, I'm a teacher, or whatever. But when we get into the questions of who am I really, we're really thrown for a loop. And the reason is pretty simple, and that is because it's ungraspable. Well, we're going to go to that place today that is ungraspable. It's ungraspable, but it's not, it is possible to experience that ungraspable nature. Okay? It's impossible to grasp it, but if we don't try to grasp it, we can't experience it. So we'll be doing that today. Okay? Now, something that you need to know, in order to look at certain aspects of the self, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give them labels, artificial labels, names, that I have found work. Okay? I will choose a label or a name, and I will ask you if I may speak to that voice. Okay? Now, this comes from a technique called voice dialogue, which was discovered by Hal and Sidra Stone, who are two psychotherapists who I studied with back in 1983-84 for a year. And this is what led me through my Zen training to come up with the big mind experience. Okay? So the first part of this is going to be very similar to voice dialogue, except they never work with groups. They work one-on-one because it's more psychological oriented. This I'm not doing for psychological reasons. My purpose is to help you have an experience of the transcendent. Okay? So I'm not trying to make you a healthier person, maybe happier, but not healthier. You can stay screwed up if you want. I don't. I am. I enjoy it. So I'm not going to try to do that. But I will use some of the therapeutic voices just to lay a foundation for you so that when we move beyond the self, you have a firm foundation. Because we do not want to build a structure on a poor foundation. Okay? We can. We could go to the last part of this workshop now, and you can all have the transcendent experience, and you'll kind of float out of here or, you know, wobble out of here and go, what just hit me? And you'll spend, like I have, the next 35 years trying to figure it all out, because that's what happened to me. So I'm going to lay some foundation so that it is not quite as shocking for you, okay? Because I don't want you to be dysfunctional by 6 o'clock today. Okay? All right. Sounds good, right? All right. So what you need to know is when I ask to speak to a specific voice in you, what I'd like you to do is shift your position in the chair to where that voice is seated. Now, that voice is seated wherever you shift to. Okay? You don't need to spend a lot of time trying to figure out where that voice is. Just the shift is important. What we know, or what at least I figured out, was that obviously everyone in this room has a different perspective of this room. Different perspective. Even if you're as close as the two of you are, you still have a slightly different perspective of the room. If we looked at it from a satellite, it would look like we all have the same perspective of this planet. But getting closer, we can see we all have a different perspective. In fact, my perspective of the room is entirely different than any of yours. Entirely different. So when we make a physical shift, it will help us or facilitate a mental shift. What I am trying to do is get you used to shifting your perspective. When we stick to one perspective, then our view of life, of reality, is very one-dimensional. It's very narrow. If we can move all around this room and look at this room, we're going to see this room from a multiple of perspectives and increase our awareness of this room. And that's what we're going to be doing with reality. We're going to be looking at different aspects of reality so that we get a better perspective and that we see there is no right perspective. There is only my perspective. Okay? And we tend to think that makes it right. Your perspective, which is your perspective and it's 100% correct, is not the only perspective. And we forget that, particularly when we deal with relationships. Relationships in the home, relationships at work, relationships with others. We tend to forget that my perspective is not the only perspective. What is very helpful is to be able to move into someone else's perspective and see it through their eyes. So we're going to be doing this to create that potential and possibility. Okay? So I'm going to ask you to switch your position when I ask to speak to a voice. Please don't do it before I ask and name the voice. Okay? If you do not understand what I'm asking for, and the chances are you will not, okay, unless you've done this before, still make the shift, and then I will ask questions that allow you to gain insight into your new perspective. Okay? That's where the facilitator comes in. Okay? I'm going to ask to speak to a voice now. I would like if you took everything off your laps. There's no need for notes. Okay. So, the first voice that I'd like to speak to, and remember, I only want to speak to that voice and no other voice. So, I'm separating you from the self now. I just want to speak to the voice of the protector. May I speak to the protector, please? All right. I am speaking to whom?
Protector.
All right. Everybody there. You're all the voice of the protector. Okay, what's your job?
Protect.
Okay, very good. Your job is to protect. Now, it never gets any more difficult than this. All right? It's not rocket science. Okay? It will never get any more difficult than this. But I will from now on ask you to raise your hand so I can hear from one of you at a time. Okay, so your job as the protector is to protect. Protect whom? From what?
Myself.
All right. So your job is to protect what?
Myself.
All right. Myself. The self. All right. Now, one of the things that I didn't mention, I'll mention it now, is why we can transcend the self is we're going to begin right now to distance you from the self. So who are you?
Protector.
You're the protector. You're not the self. Okay? You're not the self any longer. Up to now, all these years, you've been in the self. Now you are just the protector, and your job description on your forehead is to protect. One of the things you protect is the self. Okay? Got that? What do you protect the self from? Just raise your hands. Yeah.
Attack.
Okay, so you will protect the self from attack from others.
Yes.
Okay, attack. What else do you protect? Yes, sir.
Uncertainty.
Okay, you protect the self from uncertainty. Absolutely. Okay, yes.
Self-doubt.
All right, you protect the self from self-doubt. Good. Yes.
Risk.
Go ahead.
Risk.
Yes, you protect the self from taking risks. Good.
From danger.
And where can that danger come from?
Anywhere.
Anywhere, really. Isn't that true? Danger is always just lurking around the corner. It is.
Yeah.
Anything can be dangerous. Any situation. You might even be sleeping with the enemy. Right?
Yes.
I mean, he or she, probably more than anybody else in this world, can just say something or do something that can hurt really bad. So you've got to be on guard. You've got to protect the self from others and even loved ones. Yes, you had your hand.
Dissolution.
All right, from disillusionment.
Dissolution, breaking up.
Oh, from breaking up. Okay, okay.
Pain.
From pain. Good. So you protect the self from pain. I imagine you mean physical pain, but not only.
Not necessarily.
Yeah, it could be emotional pain, psychological pain. Good. Yeah.
Looking bad.
All right. So you protect the self from looking bad. So you keep up the what? The image?
Right.
Facade?
Yeah, looking good.
All right. You want it to look good. Yes.
Shame.
Okay. You protect the self from
shame.
From shame.
Bosses and authority figures.
All right. From bosses and authority figures.
Disappointment.
Yes. You protect it from disappointment. Yes, sir.
Excitement.
All right. You protect it from excitement. Tell me more about that. That's an interesting one. From getting too excited?
Yeah. Too many good feelings.
Too many good feelings. Why? What's the reason?
I don't know.
All right. But you just protect them from that because you think that potentially that can be dangerous.
Much.
Let down, disappointment. All that.
Lose control.
Lose control. Good.
From loss.
All right. From loss.
I'm having trouble separating from the self or recognizing that I'm separate.
All right. So you are, who are you?
I'm supposed to be the protector.
All right. So you are the protector. Okay. All right. You are the protector and you have a job description like any good employee. Your job description says what?
That I'm supposed to protect.
Yeah, to protect.
I was thinking of protecting like my family rather than me.
All right. You just brought us to another level, that's all. Okay, so as the protector, you do not only protect the self from other things, but you protect the family from danger.
Yeah. Right?
Right? Okay, there's more that you protect from. Let's look at it this way. One thing you do is you protect the self from the environment or others. Everything out there. You see that? You have to protect the self from everything out there because everything out there is potentially dangerous. We're all clear on this? Okay. What else do you have to protect besides the self from others? All right, go ahead.
From yourself.
All right. That's very important. As the protector, you also have to protect the self from the self, don't you? Because the self is what?
Dangerous.
Dangerous. And plenty stupid. Isn't it? It will continue to do the same stupid thing over and over and over again, like drinking too much, eating too much, not exercising, get too high, too excited, get too down, too depressed, right? So you have to protect not only the self from others, but the self from the self. Okay? What other aspects of the self do you have to protect it from, besides its own stupidity?
Get out of control.
All right. You have to protect the self from getting out of control. That's right. Being out of control. What might cause the self to get out of control?
Overconfidence.
Okay. Overconfidence. Big one.
Meeting a spiritual teacher.
Meeting a spiritual teacher could do that. Yes.
Anger.
Anger. So if the self gets so angry, you might lose control. Right?
Self-hatred.
Self-hatred. Another big one.
Loss.
Loss. Another one. Yes.
Passion.
Passion. Yeah. Passion. Fear?
Greed.
Greed. Greed.
Moving.
Moving?
Moving.
Say more, because I didn't quite get it.
Growth.
Growth. Okay. Movement. Growth. I see. Good.
I protect the self from the intellect.
All right, even from the intellect. Because the intellect can what?
Take over and distort stuff.
Take over and distort things. Good. Yes?
Lust.
Lust. That's right. Lust. What about jealousy?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Right? That's a big one. That can cause you to have some problems. Right? All right, so we're clear on two aspects. Your job is to protect the self from others, to protect the self from the self. There's another big one. Yes?
Protect others from the self?
That's right. Think about that. Just this one alone is a full-time job. Isn't it true? That as the protector, I have to protect others from Genpo. Absolutely. He or she can be very dangerous, can easily hurt others. Just a glance, just a word, just a ignoring, a rejection. Not to say more violent. Things like anger, rage, jealousy, and so forth, right? So, your job is really a 24/7 job. You see that? You have to protect the self from others, you have to protect the self from itself, and you've got to protect others from the self. So, what does that feel like? What?
Full-time job.
Full-time job. 24/7, full-time gig. And exhausting. How's the pay?
Unappreciated.
Unappreciated. Now, some of you came to this workshop probably thinking that the self is not appreciated at work. Now, here we find an employee, you, who's not appreciated by the self. One of the things that we discover in this work is that the clearer you are on your job description, the more you know what your function is, and eventually, but you don't know yet who you work for. You think you do, but you don't. You're going to find out. When we know who we work for, at that point, it is easier to do our job, and the whole company, the whole firm, works more harmoniously. If no one knows their job description, no one's ever thought about it or figured it out, how can it all go smoothly? And does it? So, as the protector, one of the ways that you protect is, what do you do to protect? Yes?
I create barriers.
That's exactly right. Thank you. I create barriers. I create walls. I create borders. I create boundaries. Now, when a barrier is somehow, what's the word, gone through, what's the word?
Breached.
Penetrated.
Breached, yeah. What, penetrated to. What do you do as a protector?
Sound the alarm.
You sound the alarm.
Try to repair it.
Try to repair it.
Send reinforcements.
Build a hive.
Send out reinforcements. And
build a bigger wall.
Build a bigger wall. You do all that. You reinforce the wall. Now, when it gets breached again, what do you do?
Same thing.
Now, what happens when the arrows start coming overhead?
Build a higher wall.
Ceiling.
You build a higher wall, and eventually you realize you need a dome. You build yourself a dome. And you make it out of the strongest alloy that you can. At one time, it was probably just mortar and bricks, concrete, cement, whatever, then steel, what is it now, titanium? I mean, you know. And all of this is to protect the self from other things. Okay? All right. How is that for the self from your perspective? Because you got to do the job, right? You got to protect it. What does the self say to you?
It's constraining.
It's restrained. It's confined. It feels imprisoned by you. That's one reason that you don't get a lot of appreciation. You don't get a lot of gratitude, and the pay stinks. Because it doesn't really appreciate your hard work. How does that make you feel that the self doesn't appreciate that you work 24/7, round the clock? How does that feel? Because I want you to get into this part.
It's unfair.
It's unfair. Yeah. It doesn't feel good.
You feel like a failure.
Yes, that's right.
Devalued.
One of the things that we're going to do is we're going to find out that every voice is like a child in a family. And some children have nice names. And some children, for not their own fault, I mean, the parents gave it to them, have horrible names. And those with bad names get treated very badly. In fact, sometimes they get put down in the basement, they get buried, they get smothered, they don't get listened to, and so forth. What we want to do is realize that every voice, every child has a right to be and a right to be heard. You wouldn't think of locking any of your kids down in the basement and throwing the key away. So as the protector, your job is also to protect these voices and make sure that they're heard. Okay? All right. I'd like to speak now to a close ally of yours, one who you work together as a team. I call you both together the guardians, and that voice is the controller. So may I speak to the voice of the controller? All right, you are?
Controller.
All right, $64,000 question. What is your job?
Controller.
That's it. To control. Control what and why?
Everything.
All right. So in short, you want to control everything. Now get this. This is real important. What does your job description say?
Control.
To control. Do you do your job?
Yes.
Do you try your best?
Yes.
What's your greatest fear?
Loss of control.
And what would you like to control besides everything, more specifically, if you could?
Yourself and others.
The self, yourself, and others. And you'd stop there?
Environment.
The weather. Even the weather. Earthquakes. Tornadoes.
Traffic.
Drivers, other drivers, well, that goes under others, right?
Time.
What was the last one?
Casino games.
The roulette wheel. All right, let's look at why you control. Why do you control the self? Yeah.
If I don't, nobody will.
If you don't control the self, no one else will. But the universe will try. In other words, if you don't keep this self in alignment and controlled, and you allow it to do some of the crazy, ridiculous, or passionate, or whatever things that it would like to do. In other words, it would love to be free. And if you didn't control it, if you don't do that, then the government, the police, others, somebody is going to do their best to put this self under control, under wraps. So better you do it than anybody else. How's the job?
Busy?
Tense. Exhausting?
Excruciating.
Yeah, excruciating.
Boring.
What?
Boring,
okay.
Overwhelming.
Overwhelming. And I think when you say boring, I think it's boring for the self. Not for you. You've got your hands full. But the self, it's boring for, because itself feels, again, trapped by your control. Feels limited by your control. Feels restricted by your control. It would like to be free of you. And in fact, what does that feel like to you when the self tries to annihilate you or get rid of you?
Betrayal.
Like you failed?
Oh, betrayal.
Oh, betrayed. Betrayal, okay. What else?
That we have to control more.
All right, so it feels like you have to even control more, harder. What else?
Threatening.
That's what I was thinking. Threatening. It's a threat when the self tries to eliminate you. And you know that's not a good idea, is it? Getting rid of you is not such a positive idea, is it? You know something about the self that the self doesn't seem to know about itself. You're kind of wise. You know it's going to do what?
Screw up.
It's going to screw up. Well said. King's English. It's going to screw up badly. Without you, it's going to mess up. It's going to be out of control. And that's going to look ugly. It's going to have a lot of fun until consequences. Karma catches up. Okay? All right, now, you control the self and you control others for what reason?
Smoothness of life.
Smoothness. There's another word. We talk to the voice that's primarily doing this job.
Yeah. To protect.
To protect. Yeah. Ultimately, your reason for controlling is to protect. Again, for the same three reasons, basically. To protect the self from others, to protect the self from the self and doing stupid things, and to protect others from the self. You control. Because it will somehow find itself in very awkward or dangerous situations. All right, now, as a controller, would you say it's true that if I want to speak to another voice, that if I didn't get your permission, I wouldn't stand much of a chance? That's right. So I'm going to ask your permission to speak to another voice, and then from then on, other voices, and if you just allow me to, and if you don't want to at any point, then you don't need to move or shift, but let me know. Okay. The voice that I'd like to speak to is I'd like to speak to the skeptic. The skeptic. All right, who am I speaking to?
The skeptic.
What's your job?
Question everything.
Doubt.
All right, to question everything, to doubt, to be skeptical. All right, well, tell me about you.
I'm a skeptic.
All right, well, let's be a little more descriptive, yeah.
What do you ask?
All right, why do you ask? Why should I do that? What's in it for me? Right? That's a lot how you work, right? What's in it for me? What do I get out of this? Why are you doing this?
I keep Tom from just falling for anything.
All right. Well, you keep him, Tom, from falling for
anything. He's a fool otherwise.
See, again, do we start to see just how intelligent each of these voices are compared to the conglomerate self? The self is kind of foolish. What we see is we need these voices to help us, because the self would just fall for every charlatan, every spiritual leader, every workshop, every seminar. It would dish out money after money for therapy and all this stuff.
Not to mention men.
And not to mention men. That's right. That's right. Because the self is rather foolish. It's so what?
Gullible.
Gullible. The self is so gullible. You, on the other hand, are quite what?
Smart.
Smart. Brilliant. It is so true. You, the skeptic, are a very bright voice. We can't say you're not the brightest bulb in the closet there. You are quite bright. And you can smell out, sniff out, seek out all this insane stuff that the self would fall victim to. And so you serve a very important purpose. The self still has some cash, doesn't it? Because of whom? The self is not in debt or in prison because of
me.
Yeah. So tell me more about you. What are you skeptical of? Yes?
Others. Sorry. The self's abilities.
All right. So one of the things that you're skeptical is of the self's abilities. Okay? Do you want to enlarge on that?
You know, possibly in this instance, to get the enlightenment offered from this.
Absolutely. All right. This is one of the reasons I'm bringing this voice out early on. Because it is only natural that you, the skeptic, might have some doubt whether the self can really do what this jerk up in front has predicted, promised. You know, that we're going to today transcend the self. All right? And you may have some doubt in this. You also said, skepticalness of others. Right? Right. So, tell me more about that.
Others may be dangerous to me.
All right. So you also serve to protect, like the protector and like the controller, to protect the self from others because they may be dangerous. Or they may want something of you that you're not ready to give. Or wouldn't be the right thing for you, for your family, etc., to give or to do. Yes.
I'm skeptic of my other voices.
All right. So you have skepticism of your other voices. Good. Good. If you don't, who would? See? If you don't, nobody else would. That's why every voice is critical. Every voice is crucial. Every voice is really important. Yeah.
Skeptical of the skeptic.
All right, you're even skeptical of yourself, the skeptic. That's right. And I'll tell you one thing that you need to be skeptical of is your ability to do your job completely. To do your job completely. You need to be skeptical of that because sometimes you stop short of really doubting, really going into it. Why? What comes up?
Trust.
But it comes up as the opposite. Lack of trust. Yeah, fear. Yeah. Sometimes fear comes up. Right?
Say more.
Do you know that if you did your job completely, now you're going to be skeptical of this, but that's your job. That's why I was hesitating from telling you, but you'll be skeptical, but if you did your job completely, you'd be enlightened right now. The self would be?
Would be where?
The self would be enlightened right now because you are one of the most direct doors to enlightenment. If you were skeptical of all the self's concepts, ideas, notions, opinions, beliefs, guess what?
I'm not buying that.
Yeah, of course. I said you wouldn't.
I'm not buying that.
No, no. That's why I wasn't going to put that out yet. But
I may be buying it, but I don't think I'm up to the task now.
All right, all right. And you're maybe not at this moment, and you might be in a couple hours. Are any of you skeptical? Let's say that the self does get it. Are you skeptical about its ability to hold on to it?
Yes.
Yeah. Or to bring it into everyday life?
Yes.
Or its value? You're not skeptical about that? You better be. I'm not sure it has any. All right, so let's move on. May I speak now to the voice of fear? All right, you are?
Fear.
Voice of fear. So what's your function?
Be afraid.
Be afraid.
Be afraid. Be afraid.
Raise the flag.
How are you appreciated? I saw a bunch of heads go like this. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I don't need appreciation, it's my duty.
All right, so you don't need appreciation, and therefore you probably don't get much, right? It's your duty. Your duty is to be afraid of what and when?
Them.
Them, okay. When, all the time. It's true, right? You're afraid of them basically all the time. What is it that you're afraid of them about or for? Why?
They're dangerous.
They're dangerous. They are dangerous. Pretty simple, isn't it? Yes.
Death.
Okay, so you're also afraid of death. And death is always just right there. Could happen at any time. So you're around all the time. What else are you afraid of besides death?
Yeah. Change.
Change. Change. Unpredictability. Change, right? What else?
Humiliation.
Humiliation. It's another big one. Yes, sir.
Life.
Life. Yeah. Afraid of death and life.
Annihilation.
Annihilation. Good.
Pain.
Pain.
Being found out.
Being found out. Tell me more.
Being found out that I'm someone who's afraid all the time.
All right. All right. That's right. Being discovered or found out that you're someone who's afraid all the time.
There's reason to be.
Yeah. How many of you are afraid all the time? As fear? As fear, every hand should be up. Or you're not doing your job. Isn't it true? Your job is also 24/7. You don't get to rest.
I'm afraid to be afraid.
All right. You're even afraid to be afraid. Are you afraid to rest?
Yes.
Yeah. It's got to be what kind of situation to really completely rest?
Safe.
Safe. Yeah.
Afraid of certainty and of uncertainty.
All right. And maybe even better said the other way, right? Afraid of uncertainty, but also afraid of certainty. Yeah.
Afraid to find out who I am.
Yes, absolutely. Afraid to find out who I truly am.
Afraid to let go.
Afraid to let go. You guys are doing great.
Conflict.
You're afraid of conflict, yeah. Yeah.
Afraid I'll be disappointed.
Yes, yes. Disappointed in who I am. Afraid of what's just beneath that surface, who I might be, yes.
Afraid I might be nothing.
Aha, that's a big fear, isn't it? Afraid I might be nothing. Can I increase that fear?
Afraid
you might
be.
You just might be. So, our job is to be afraid. Now, we're also constantly what? As fear?
Alert.
Alert. That's right. So one of your attributes as fear is you're very alert, you're very attuned. You're constantly scoping the situation. Because if you don't, who's going to?
Nobody.
So you do have a positive function, right? Yeah. You are there to what?
Raise the alarm.
Raise the alarm. Warn the self. Protect the self, right? You're there to raise the alarm, to tell the self, this is a dangerous situation. Get out, do this, whatever you have to, run, flee, fight, whatever you've got to do. This is dangerous. So you're very tuned in. You're very sharp. Not on the, maybe the, is the skeptic intellectually, but you're tuned in. You're alert. Got it?
Perceptive.
Perceptive, right? So what I'm trying to bring up in each voice is both your positive and negative attributes. Okay? And one of your positive attributes that you want to work on is, as the voice of fear, of being alert, being aware, being conscious, you know, looking around. Slightly, but not necessarily paranoid, but, you know, it's dangerous out there. Okay? Because you're the one who can do that. Right? Now, of course, you're not always well-liked and well-received. In fact, the self tries to do what to you?
Ignore,
or even worse.
Destroy you,
get rid of you. Yeah, I think I spent about 30 years trying to get rid of fear. And in fact, I did a pretty good job of it. You disown it. Yeah, don't let the self disown you.
Yeah. I'm not sure if this is the right time for this question, but I'm curious about the difference between the fear voice and the protective voice.
All right, as the voice of fear, you are different. Your role is also to protect, okay? The protector's only role is protect, and it has assistance. And some of the assistants are the skeptic, the controller, and you, the fear, okay? Now, you also have assistance in doing your work, okay? So you sound the alarm of fear, then you've got the controller, and you've got other voices to do something about it. All you can do is just increase the metabolism and the sweat and, you know, all these physical things, but you can't really do anything about it. Maybe run.
But I work for protect.
Yeah, but you work to protect. Yeah.
I'm fearful of everything.
Yeah, that's right. And that's your job. Your job as fear is to fear everything. That's your job, to be frightened. All right. I would like to ask to speak to another voice now. I'd like to speak to the victim. The victim. May I speak to the victim, please? You are?
The victim.
Okay, what's your job?
To blame.
To blame. Isn't that interesting?
To suffer.
Yeah, I mean, your job is to be the victim, and what you immediately do is you blame. And who do you blame?
Others.
Everybody else.
Yeah, everybody else, and including
the self.
Even including the self. Yeah? Sometimes you blame the self. So tell me more about you.
Yeah. I'm persecuted.
You're persecuted. Yeah. Yeah.
And I love it.
And I love it. And one further thing. I'm persecuted, I love it, and I like to
suffer.
Persecute.
I like to persecute. I like to tell the story. Yeah, I like telling the story because it gives her sympathy, gets her sympathy.
It's not my fault, I'm innocent.
All right, it's just not my fault, I'm innocent.
It gets me attention.
All right, it gets him attention, right? Your story gets him attention. Tell me more about you as the victim.
Persecuted.
You're persecuted. Who persecutes you?
Everyone else and myself.
All right, so the works. Everybody else and the self all persecute you.
It leads to despair and to death.
What does?
The victim.
Well, you're not speaking as the victim, are you? I lead.
The victim.
I.
I.
See, okay, let's back up a little bit, because this is very important. If we can get you to distance yourself from the self, it's going to be easier when we get into the transcendent. So that's what we're working on right now. So if you keep saying the victim, then you're not speaking as the victim. So I, the victim. Yeah. Lead. Or that's what I thought you started to say. Lead.
I, the victim. The victim has emotion.
See, you did it again.
I have emotion.
Okay.
Which leads to despair.
Okay.
Which leads to death.
Okay. So, I, as the victim, okay, have all kinds of emotions. And that leads to despair and eventually to death. Okay. Now, is that part of your story as the victim?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
A small part.
Small part, but it is part of it.
That's why I don't allow the victim, or the self doesn't allow the victim.
You're doing it again. You started right. That's why the self doesn't allow me.
Doesn't allow me.
To
have control.
To have control, or to be out, or to be there. That's right. Now, you see where it's so true, you're a disowned voice. And when we find a disowned voice, it's very difficult to stay in voice. That's how you know a voice is disowned. It's very difficult. You have some unclarity. You kept wanting to go back as the self and talk about the victim, not be the victim. Got it? Yes? No?
I get it.
You get it. Okay.
The world's unfair.
The world is unfair. Yeah. From your position, the world is very unfair.
I feel sorry for myself.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I know what should be done.
All right. Okay.
I love my job.
You love your job. And you love telling your story, right? Yeah. You love telling your story.
I need to be protected.
Yes. You need more protection. Yes, that's part of it.
I'm in real pain, but nobody understands.
All right, nobody understands me. I'm in real pain, and nobody gets it.
I don't know why it keeps happening to me.
Yeah, why does it keep happening to me? Yes.
I didn't have a choice.
Okay, I didn't have a choice.
I'm trying so hard.
Yes.
I know the others don't get paid at all, but I get paid the least.
Others don't get paid at all, and I get paid even less. You're in the negative, huh?
I'm tired fighting, and I just need a break.
All right, you're just so tired of fighting, and you need a break, yeah.
But I don't know what I'm good for.
All right, you don't even know what you're good for. You're such a victim. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When you tell your story, what does the self get?
Sympathy.
Sometimes. Attention. But I think it'll become clear what you're good for as soon as we go to the next voice.
But in all this, I hold the suffering.
All right. You hold the suffering.
I suffer and I
at least you hold the story.
This works for me.
That works, right? You hold the story. Okay? But it is a story. It doesn't seem like a story to you. It seems like the truth, reality. But it is the story. You hold the story. Yes?
I feel very righteous.
Yes. Yes. Very righteous.
I feel like this is the first voice I'm in now among these voices you've chosen for us, where the ego has to do something for me rather than I'm doing something for the ego. The ego has to help me feel good.
Yeah.
And has to protect me from feeling too bad, or I go into despair.
Right.
So I'm. So the ego has to work for me rather than I'm working for the ego. Or at least that's how I'm seeing it.
Well, yeah. I mean, you're saying it as a perfect victim. A helpless,
yeah, that's right.
A perfect
that's
helpless
right.
Victim. This is the voice that I want the ego to help me.
Right.
Right, because I am a victim.
I have no power.
No power, yeah. As a victim, I feel powerless. Now, how do you come out in the work field, you know, the workplace? Yeah.
I give and give and no one tries to reciprocate.
I give and nobody what?
Tries to reciprocate.
Reciprocates, yeah. Yes?
I have a lot of friends.
A lot of friends?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I ring in sick and I usually can make it sound good.
Aha. Uh-huh. You're the one who rings in sick and makes it sound good.
I don't want this voice.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I think that's what we're finding out. This victim voice is not a nice voice for you.
No.
No. Would you allow me to speak, just her, the rest just stay as a victim. Allow me to speak to the voice of resistance. Okay, you are. What voice?
I am resisting.
Resistance. Okay. Your job is?
To resist.
To resist. Okay. What about this voice? Are you resisting allowing it out?
Because I'm protecting.
Okay. You're protecting. Now, what is so scary about letting the victim out?
Because of death.
Death?
Yes.
So the way you see it, if you allow the victim out, it will lead to death?
Yes.
Okay, so you choose not to. How will it lead to death? Depression? Despair?
Weakness.
Ah, weakness.
As a cancer survivor,
uh-huh.
I don't allow the victim. The protector does not allow the victim to manifest itself.
All right, so as resistance, you notice that the protector will not allow the victim out as a cancer survivor. Okay, good. That's good work. Okay. Let me speak to fear, please. Okay, I'm speaking to?
To fear.
Fear, okay. So your job is?
Is to alert the protector.
Right, and so that's what you're doing right now.
Yes.
You're fearing letting this voice out. And you're alerting the protector not to. Okay, let's just sit with that fear, or this fear. Let's just sit with it. And tell me what you feel and what you're experiencing.
I allow a greater power to help invoke the protector.
Okay, so you're calling on a greater power and the victim is a weak voice, is that, am I right? Kind of a sign of weakness? No?
Never thought of it, yes, it would be a sign of weakness.
Yeah, it would be a sign of weakness. And the fear is what? If we let it out.
The fear is that I would not have courage.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's the fear. There'd be no courage if you let the victim out. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Let me speak to the self for a minute. Okay. You are?
I'm the self.
You're the self. Okay. Would you feel more comfortable to keeping the victim from speaking?
Yes.
Okay. And you feel like now is not the appropriate time maybe to let the victim speak?
Yes.
Okay. That's fine. All right. So while we go through this, you can just remain as the self, and then when we switch voices, you can come make that shift with us. Okay?
Thank you.
All right. I'd like now to speak to another voice. Okay? I would like to speak to the damaged self. The damaged self. Okay. And you are?
Damaged self.
Damaged self. So who are you? What are you? Yeah.
I was abused in my childhood.
All right. You're damaged, you were abused in your childhood, you're broken, someone said.
I'm hidden.
You're hidden? Hidden.
I stay hidden.
Mm-hmm. You stay hidden. He keeps you hidden.
Mm-hmm. I'm not worth much.
Okay, you're damaged and broken, and you're not worth very much.
Yeah.
I have scars.
Scars.
Mm-hmm. I'm stronger.
You're stronger. Stronger than?
Than the previous, before I was
right.
damaged.
Okay. You're stronger because of the damage.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
I'm lost.
You're lost. You mean as the damaged self, you're lost?
I feel lost.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Okay.
I'm the excuse for the other voices not being successful.
Oh, okay. You're used as the excuse. I'll tell you something. You're the reason all the other voices are whole, complete, and perfect, and intact. You're used as the excuse, but you're the one who has taken every bullet, every arrow, every dagger, every insult, every rejection, every hurt. You have taken it completely on. And in fact, when it's coming and you are faster than a speeding bullet, you jump right in front of that bullet and you take it. That's why you are damaged. Now, what does that make you?
Unhappy.
Unhappy? Crazy?
The hero.
Heroic. Yeah.
It's a brave action, but I don't get to feel any positive benefit of it.
Yeah, you don't need to, or you don't?
I just don't.
You don't, yeah. No. You are a hero in my estimation. Okay? However, you just feel what?
Damaged.
Damaged. Damaged. And really damaged, yes.
There's no glory.
No. No, there's no glory. And nobody's going to put up banners for you or anything else. It's just what you do. And why do you do it?
It's my job.
It's your job.
It's as simple as that. That's what you were hired to do. The garbage collector is hired to collect the garbage. You know, the CEO is hired to run the corporation. You were hired to collect all the damage. You are a receptacle of all the damage. We could not do this work that we're doing and about to do if it weren't for you. Because all these voices would have shared all that damage that's gone on. Because it's gone on since when?
Since
birth. Maybe even pre-birth. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know how I'm differentiate myself from
the self?
Victim. From the victim.
Oh, from the victim. Okay, well, that's what we want to do. That's why I asked to speak to the victim first. So you are?
Damaged.
Damaged. And the victim is? He's the victim. He's the story. He tells your story.
Yeah.
You're the one who has taken all the shit.
I didn't even get to tell the story.
And you don't even get to tell the story. You're so damaged, even by the victim. The victim tells the story of how you got damaged over and over again, and you don't get to do that.
I'm a fool.
No, you're damaged. The fool's the fool.
Oh.
You're just damaged.
I feel pretty heroic and proud, and I just noticed other damaged ones didn't, so I wanted to know if I'm in touch with that.
I think that's fine, because you are the one who always, no matter what the situation, takes it on. I think it's heroic. Okay? Not everybody might feel that way because you're damaged. But if not you, then who? And the answer is somebody else would have been hit or hurt. And no one else has been. You have gone all these years, the self has, gone all these years, and other than you being damaged, none of the other voices have ever been damaged. Totally intact. Perfect as day one. Just whole and complete as they were from the beginning.
Lucky them.
What?
Lucky them.
Lucky them and unlucky you. But somebody had to do it.
I'm perfect and whole as a damaged.
That's right. You're perfect. You're a perfectly damaged self.
That's right.
That's right. That's absolutely right.
And I will continue to be.
That's right. And look at it. Will you continue to take on more damage?
No.
Will you ever stop?
No.
When are you going to be fixed?
Never.
Never. Never.
Does the self try to fix you?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. It does. Waste of time. It's an absolute waste of time.
Well, that's a relief.
Oh, yeah, I just saved you $60,000. Yeah. It's a waste of time to try to fix you because you will continue to jump in front of every arrow and every bullet and every insult and every damage. Yes.
Even though I don't want to, I feel like I'm holding the self back from some of its growth.
You might feel that way. I don't think you are. I think that if the self is identified too much with you, that might hold it back. But what we're doing here is we're separating you from the self. You're the damaged self. You're not the self. You're the damaged self. You're the part of the self that has been damaged. You're not the whole.
I'm not sure I believe that.
Okay, as the damaged self?
I can't perceive another self.
You might not be able to, but we're going to talk to another self at some point. We've been talking to other aspects of the self, but you may not be able to perceive that. You and the self might be so entwined that you may not see that yet. That's why we're doing this. We're doing this to get some space, to get some distance, to create some distance and space so that everything becomes really clear and functions better, more functional.
Even Ken says that psychotherapy is useful, and that's one of the lines that needs to be developed in order to progress.
That's what we're doing.
So, but if there's the damaged self is always damaged, and there's no use in trying to fix the damaged
self.
That's
right.
There's some kind of habits or something of the ego that.
There is absolutely. No way that we're ever going to fix you so that you don't exist.
Okay.
Okay? If in 20 years we get together again and I say, may I speak to you, the damaged self, who's going to speak?
The damaged self.
The damaged self, right? So it's a waste of time to try to fix you, but it's not a waste of time to do psychotherapy. It's just a waste of time to try to fix you. We're doing psychotherapy right now.
Question?
Yeah.
But if you fix it, all you're doing is removing some of the damage so it can take damage, so they can take more damage better. If you get rid of all the damage, then you've destroyed the damaged self.
Yeah, we're not going to get rid of all the damage.
But if you get rid of some of the damage, it's like, you know, so.
All right, but who's speaking?
The damaged self.
All right, so you started to say if you get rid of some of the damage. You mean if we get rid of some of you?
Mm-hmm. If you get rid of some of the things that I take on, I can take on more better.
Oh, I don't doubt that. You might get rid of some of the damage that you've taken on, but that's not your job or concern or worry.
But if the other parts want to do that, I don't want them to be hurt, so I have to take on their stuff as well.
You have to take it all on.
Even the desire to help me.
Even what?
Even their desire to get rid of the damage.
Oh, yeah. And you'll probably see some of that as more damage. Won't you? Probably.
Depends.
It might damage you more.
It might not.
And it might not. Okay. All right. Let's speak now to one of those who is trying to fix you, the fixer. Let's speak to the fixer. Okay, you are?
Fixer.
You are the fixer. So your job is?
Fix
things. So who are you most trying to fix?
The damaged self.
Your job is to fix the damaged self. So let me just ask you very bluntly, when are you going to get it done? What?
Second half of this program.
Fat chance.
But I don't want to be done, because then I'd have nothing to do.
That's right. So as the fixer, what do you constantly do?
Fix.
Just try.
Yeah, and if you get something fixed, what do you do?
Look for something else.
You look for something else. And if you get that fixed?
Look for something else.
Look for something else. Let's say you get it all fixed. Let's say you get the whole self fixed. What?
There's something must be wrong.
Yeah, and there's something left to fix. So if you're a hammer, everything else is
a nail.
I'll just find other people to fix.
That's right. So if you get the self fixed, then you just move on and try to fix others. Now, let's just imagine, but I think it's impossible. Let's just say we fix the world. And what do we do?
I tamper with it.
You will tamper with it. You will actually break it in order to fix it better. You will
know how to fix it.
That's right. Your job is to fix.
Quality management. Continuous improvement.
How many of you earn your living fixing? Yeah, I think a lot. What else would you like to say as the fixer? Yes.
If I just try a little bit harder, I can do it.
Okay. If I just would try a little harder, I could get it fixed. Okay.
I serve the controller.
Yes, you serve the controller.
If it wasn't for me, I don't know if all these other guys would be around.
That's right. That's right. If it weren't for you, they might not even be around, because your job is to keep them fixed. Yeah.
I believe I know more than the universe.
Okay, you know even more than the universe, and therefore can fix the universe. Yeah, you're very intelligent.
My right hand is the skeptical.
All right, the skeptic is your right hand.
Right.
I feel very arrogant about being you. I can fix anything. There isn't anything I can't fix. I don't try, I fix.
Yeah, that's right. You don't try, you just fix. Right. Yeah. Arrogant or confident?
Confident.
Oh, I was going to say confident.
It's both.
There's nothing that you couldn't give me that I couldn't fix.
Yeah, so it sounds arrogant, but it's also you got a lot of confidence in your ability to fix. Yeah.
I love tools.
Uh-huh. Yes, I love tools.
And there's always got to be a better hammer.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
There's no past or present. There's only future.
Okay. There's only future.
I'll use anything.
Yes. You'll use anything to get the job fixed, done.
I'm a perfectionist.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So you'll fix until it's perfect. Yeah.
It can always be better.
Can always be better. Good. Yes?
Everything is doomed to break, so I'm heartbroken.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Well, I'd never be out of a job.
Yeah, that's true, too. You'd never be out of a job. You could look at it the positive side. Never be out of a job. There'll always be more to fix.
Imperfection is my friend.
Uh-huh. All right, let's move on. I'd like to speak to another voice. I'd like to speak to the vulnerable child, please. Vulnerable child. Okay, you are?
The vulnerable child.
All right, let's just be as the vulnerable child for a minute. and see what it's like to be the vulnerable child.
It's little.
Dependent on others.
Dependent, small.
I'm naive.
Powerless.
I'm naive. I'm naive.
Naive. Okay.
It's nice as long as I've got all my protectors around me.
All right. As long as you got all these protectors around, it's nice.
It's lonely.
Lonely.
I trust everybody.
All right. I trust everyone. Yeah.
It's confusing.
What's confusing?
The world.
The world is. Would you say like a mystery?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a mystery. Now remember, you are the vulnerable child. The damaged self is the one that has been
damaged.
The victim is the one who has
story.
You are the pure, vulnerable child. Prior to the story, prior to the damage. And you are unharmed. That's why I go in this order. You are unharmed. So be the vulnerable child and see what you offer the self. Because you offer a tremendous amount.
Can I go play now?
That's one of the things that you offer. Fun, play, yes.
I feel sad and scared.
You feel sad and scared. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. I trust they'll be taken care of.
You trust who? Yeah, you trust that you'll be taken care of, yes.
Caution. I offer caution because I feel threatened.
Okay.
Innocence. Innocence.
Innocence. Yeah, you offer innocence. All right, let me throw out some words. Innocence, trust, creativity, fun, joy, newness,
spontaneity, carefree,
aliveness, what was that?
Carefree.
Carefree.
Mm-hmm. Fearless.
Fearless.
Curious.
Curious.
Open.
Open. Thank you. You are completely open. Yes.
Wonder.
Wonder. Thank you again. That's great.
Sensitive.
Sensitive. Yes.
Honest.
Honest. Honest. And you have an integrity, don't you?
Transparent.
Yes.
Loving.
Loving.
Delighted.
Delighted. What?
I don't hear the vulnerable part.
So vulnerable.
I hear the child part.
All right.
The so wonderful, positive right. parts
so vulnerable
of child.
Means, doesn't vulnerable mean open?
I think of it in terms of open.
I wondered, okay, that's what I thought, all right? That's what I thought. Yeah. Len's speaking, right? Len is coming through. The self is coming through, and the self has some notions about the vulnerable child.
When you said vulnerable child, I went into what I thought, what, yeah, I guess what I thought was vulnerable child.
That's right. That's right. That's right. So, would you allow me now to speak to the vulnerable child without any preconceived ideas?
Okay.
All right. So you are?
Vulnerable child.
All right. Now just see what it's like to be this child, this infant, that's completely vulnerable, completely open. Be a new experience. Prior to the stories, prior to the damage, prior to the propaganda. It's nice, isn't it? What do you offer him?
I see my own ego stories right now.
Oh, yeah.
That's interesting.
Isn't that nice? Yeah, you offer spontaneity, creativity, openness, trust. When you're shut down because of the stories, guess who is really shut down? What part of the human being are you? Part of the self?
Enthusiasm.
Yeah, but what part?
Heart.
The heart, the soul, the spirit. The center. What? The center?
I feel like the center.
The center, yeah. In Japanese, we have the word shin, which all means that. Shin means heart, center, soul, spirit. Yeah, mind, the essence. True self, true nature. You're the self's true essence. Before all the shit hit the fan.
I feel uncensored.
Uncensored. That's absolutely. Rich.
Abundant.
Abundant, that's right.
Innocent.
Totally.
Free.
Free. That's one that hasn't been said. You're totally free. Free to what?
Infinite possibilities.
Yeah, infinite possibilities. Free to be, free to do, free to discover, free to explore.
Isn't part of that what we were trying to protect earlier?
That's right. So, you got it. All right. So, all these other voices were, remember we talked about voices in order to protect. Who are they all trying to protect? Yeah. If the walls get penetrated, if the skeptic, the people who are out to harm, you know, to take advantage, penetrate it, the damaged self will take on the damage. It's all about you, protecting you, so that the core, that the center, the heart, stays completely unhurt. And that's why we can speak to you, because all these other voices have, maybe not always so well, but the damaged self took up the slack, did their job. When the damage came in, the damaged self got in there and took it up, so that you can be, and you are, just perfect and complete and whole as you are. Isn't that beautiful?
It's excellent.
Yeah. It is. It is. Let's just sit as the vulnerable child. Just bathe as the vulnerable child. What's this like for you?
Peaceful.
Peaceful?
Joy.
Joy. Joyful.
Playful.
Playful.
Fresh air.
Mm-hmm.
Excited.
Yeah.
Pure.
Pure. This is meditation. Not necessarily what some of you might have learned as meditation, particular posture, particular breathing. This is meditation. I want to speak to another voice. May I speak to the voice of desire, please? Desire. All right, you are?
Desire.
Voice of desire. Okay, what do you do?
I lust. Just can't get enough.
All right, I caught a bunch of things there. So I lust, I desire, I want. What else did I hear? I crave. So tell me about you.
I can't get enough.
All right, so one of your attributes is you can never get enough.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
I'm needy,
yeah.
I want more.
Always. Always more. And when you get more, what do you want?
More.
Okay.
And better.
Or something else.
I yearn. I yearn for more. I yearn for it to be better, for different. What else?
I know the next thing I want will make me happier.
Okay. Always the next thing that I want is going to make her happier. Or you happier.
I'm the agent of growth.
Okay. Agent of growth. Okay, because you desire to grow, to mature.
Don't have enough now.
That's right.
I'm greedy,
yes. Yes.
I'm aggressive. Nothing gets in my way.
All right. So as desire, you can be very aggressive.
Yes.
Nothing gets in your way, yeah.
Consequences I'll deal with later.
Okay. Now,
I want something, but when I get it, I don't enjoy it because I want something else while I'm getting what I wanted.
Right. It's so true. You are insatiable. The moment you get something, you want something else, and you never can seem to be satisfied or enjoy what you just got, because you're already on to the next bite. It's like chain smoking, isn't it? Or like before you've even swallowed that Ben and Jerry's, you've got the shovel into the ice cream for another one. Yeah.
Secretive.
You're secretive. Tell me more about that.
I don't want anyone to know how strong I really am.
Oh, okay. So you're kind of...
I hide myself.
All right. That's one of your desires, is not to be found out. How thirsty and hungry, yeah.
Insatiable I am.
How insatiable you are. So, you have gotten a bum rap, particularly in religions, maybe particularly in Buddhism. In fact, the Buddha said you are what?
Evil.
What?
Evil?
Cause of suffering.
The cause of suffering. Bad. Evil. The cause of suffering. You are the cause of suffering. However, if it weren't for you, where would this self be right now?
Nowhere.
Not here.
Nowhere.
Nowhere?
Lower. Still. What? Still. Not moving? Yeah. No development. In fact, the whole human species would be where?
In caves.
It wouldn't even be in caves, right? Because you desire food, right? You desire shelter. Why wouldn't it exist then? Yeah, it wouldn't exist. Why would human beings desire a cave if they have no desire? You see? So you are absolutely essential. The self sometimes, however, tries to what?
Eliminate you.
That's right. The self does try to eliminate you sometimes.
I'm constantly trying to get out from control.
Yes, getting out from his control, or the controller's control. That's right. Now, how is it that you cause suffering?
Attach.
You attach. So one of your desires is you attach to what?
Well, whatever you desire.
All right, whatever you desire. I'm kind of looking for another word here. What about you attach to things that are?
Pleasurable.
Pleasurable. Right? We're getting into Buddhism 101 now. You attach to things that are pleasurable, and you desire those things that bring pleasure, and you don't desire the things that
bring pain,
suffering, or displeasure. So you attach and you cling and you desire, or it's probably the other order, you desire, you attach, and you cling to the things that bring pleasure, and you desire the opposite of those things that bring you pain and suffering. Okay, so you avoid those. All right, let me speak now to the seeking mind, the seeking mind. And you are?
Seeking mind.
All right, and what do you do?
Seek.
You seek. What do you seek?
Knowledge.
Wisdom.
Knowledge, wisdom.
I seek to be better.
All right, I seek to be better.
Okay. To improve, yeah.
To improve.
Dissolution of karma.
I seek enlightenment.
Dissolution of karma.
The disillusionment of karma.
To know.
To know, to understand. I seek to understand. Yes.
Latest theory.
All right, I seek the latest theory. Therefore, you brought the self here. I mean, it is true that you're the one who brought the self here. Yeah? Because you're seeking knowledge, enlightenment, what?
Understanding.
Understanding, a better way of life, right? And what?
I seek an escape from pain.
An escape from pain. Now, how are you related to the voice of desire?
I seek the things I desire.
All right, so you seek what the desiring mind desires.
Yes.
Yeah, you seek what it desires. Yeah.
Desire is my motivator, but I am the part that's capable of finding it.
All right, so desire is your motivator, but you're the one capable of seeking it, not finding it.
Right.
You've never found the thing. You just seek. It's true, isn't it?
Yeah, one of the best of
You just seek. If you did find something, what would you do?
Look for something else.
You'd seek something more. That's what you do. Your job written on your forehead is to
seek. But I carry desire to a higher level.
You do. Good for you. You carry desire to a higher level. In fact, you are somehow better than.
Oh, yeah. Way better.
Better than, right? Desire is kind of what?
Base.
Base.
I see things worth seeking.
That's right. All right. Now, allow me to speak to the mind that seeks the way. The mind that seeks the way. All right, so what is it that you seek?
The way.
All right, so you seek the way. All right, let's sit with this for a moment. And let's discover who you are. You are the mind that seeks the way. All right, talk to me about you. Tell me about you, who you are, yeah.
I'm discerning.
You're discerning, very good. Yes?
I'm somewhat unfulfilled.
All right, you're somewhat unfulfilled. You're not satisfied yet, but you are?
Actually, I'm frustrated.
Frustrated, okay. You're frustrated because you're seeking the way, and what is it that's frustrating you?
It's a roller coaster.
Okay.
Up and down.
Up and down.
Steps forward.
All right.
Forget what I've learned.
All right. So as the mind that seeks the way, you get frustrated. It's a roller coaster.
I'm devoted.
Yes, you are devoted. To what?
To keep seeking.
That's right. That's right. You are devoted to keep seeking. And what you're seeking is the way. So what is this way that you're seeking? Yes?
Wisdom.
Okay, the way is wisdom, okay?
The highest potential of myself and mankind.
All right, so what you're seeking as the way is the highest potential for the self and all mankind.
I am the way.
No, No, she might be. You are?
Seeking.
You are seeking the way. And you have a sneaking suspicion that she might be the way. But you're still the one that's seeking the way. You jumped ahead of us.
I seek meaning.
Okay, I seek meaning. Meaning. What else do you seek? Yes?
Peace.
Peace. That's right. Peace.
Purpose.
Purpose. All right, let me focus a little bit on purpose. I seek peace, I seek purpose. Purpose means that by seeking purpose and meaning, guess what you give to the self?
Purpose.
Purpose and meaning. Let that sink in a little bit. By seeking purpose and meaning, what you offer the self is purpose and meaning. When the mind that seeks the way is awakened, and you are now awakened because I'm speaking to you, you're no longer in the closet, the mind that seeks the way gives meaning and purpose for this life. It also gives other things besides meaning and purpose. What else?
Motivation.
Motivation. There's another one that's so obvious.
Direction.
Direction. You give the self direction. Now, what self can't use a little direction, a little meaning, and a little purpose in this world? And you're the one that offers it. No other voice before that can offer this. The mind that seeks is beginning, but it has all kinds of things it seeks. Right? You are very focused.
I've thought that I've found the way many times, but I end up seeking again.
All right. Now, let me ask you, because this, she said, I've thought I have found the way many times.
I have found the way.
Yeah, I've found the way many times, and I still end up seeking. In 20 years, let's say we come back together, and I say, may I speak to the mind that seeks the way? Will you still be here?
Yes.
What will you still be doing?
Seeking the way.
Now, you can graduate here.
That's very sad.
The truth hurts. Someone once said the truth sucks. This is very important, so get this. Your job is only
seek
the way. You will always seek the way, unless you get annihilated. You get suppressed, repressed, or disowned. Do you want to be disowned?
No.
No. Do not let it happen. The way, and finding the way, other voices may come into play and say, well, the way is higher than you, the seeker of the way, and may try to disown you. Don't let it happen, because you offer the self something no other voice can offer. Because the self would love to what? You said it earlier in another voice. It'd love to
attach.
It'd love to cling, particularly to the way. So what you offer the self is freedom from attachment.
I feel diminished in the realization that as I seek purpose and meaning, I actually create purpose and meaning. I feel myself spinning in circles.
I'm not sure why. Okay? Because this is what you offer. By the raising, and you're called the Bodhi mind, to use the technical term. By raising the Bodhi mind, the mind that seeks the way, you offer meaning, direction, and purpose to this life. The very seeking the way is the way. Is what we're looking for. But because your job is solely to seek the way, you get to never find it. So you're never satisfied. That has a negative and a positive side. Negative in that you will never be satisfied. you will always just keep seeking the way. Positive side is that you will keep the self from getting stuck. Now, my grandfather in the Dharma used to say, practice is like a circle. The first thing he always did was draw a circle on the blackboard before he spoke. Practice is like a circle. Every one of us is somewhere on that circle. It doesn't matter where. The point is, don't get stuck wherever you are. Keep moving. It doesn't matter if we're at the beginning or the end, because the end only becomes the beginning again anyways, or somewhere in between. The point is, don't get stuck any place. Keep moving. You are the one who offers that. And if you understand this, you will save the self tons of problems. Tons.
It's a journey, not a destination.
That's right. It's a journey. And you are aware of the journey. You're looking for the destination, but it is the journey. All right. Let me speak now to another voice. I'd like to speak to the follower of the way. The follower of the way, please. All right, you are?
Follower of the way.
All right, so who are you?
I follow.
What do you follow?
The way.
I follow the way. Sit with this for a moment. This is interesting. I follow the way. See what has to be so in order for you to follow the way.
To find a way?
I have to know it
first.
Well, you have to see something, huh, to follow.
I need direction.
You need direction. So you have to see something. So what is it that you have to get a glimpse of?
Way.
The way. The way. Or at least.
Anyway.
No. At least.
Faith.
The next step.
Traces, tracks. Maybe you don't quite see the way yet. Maybe. Maybe you do, but maybe you don't. But you can see the way has been here. Look, the grass is flattened right here. The twig is broken right there. The way has been here, so I can follow the way. I have to have something to follow if I'm going to follow the way. So it may be that I actually see the way. And maybe I only see a part of the way, or a glimpse of the way, or maybe I only see traces of the way, tracks of the way. But I have to see something to follow the way. All right. So, tell me more about you.
I get stuck easily. On the path, whatever that way is.
All right, so you sometimes get stuck.
It's easy to get stuck or attached.
All right, but your job is to then...
To follow.
To keep following.
So that's how I get stuck, by keeping following.
All right, but you also, the self gets stuck sometimes, and your job is to keep it moving, because that way is constantly moving on. The way doesn't stand still for you. You know, it's kind of ungraspable. Everybody? It's not just sitting and waiting for you like a lame duck. It's keep moving, and so your job is to keep following.
I was thinking in terms of being falling into the trap of organizations that just keep you trapped.
Okay, got it. Yeah, that's true.
Because that's the way for many people.
Yeah, that is.
Some of these other characters, the controller, the protector, fear, like to get in my way.
They do. That's right. They will sometimes get in your way. They will try to sabotage.
Skeptic.
Yeah, skeptic is a big one. No. But your job is to what?
Be persistent.
Be persistent. Yeah. To just not pay too much heed to that and to move on. Keep going. Keep following. You got to keep up with the way. The way's moving fast. They thought in the old days it was an ox, but it turns out to be a thoroughbred.
Have faith.
Have faith. You have to have faith. In order to follow, there must be an element of faith and trust. There's something else that's different about you, and it's the first voice that it's different. Yes?
I control my behavior in order to conform to the way.
That's right. You're very disciplined because you have to control his behavior in order to conform to the way. There's still an element that's been not said.
Surrender.
That's it.
Devoted.
Surrender. In order to follow, you have to submit. You have to surrender. You can't follow if you're not willing to submit to the way. You just go your own way. Now, there's a lot of selves that do that. Instead of following the way, the self wants to say, well, follow me. I'm the way. It's a little bit tricky that way. It's kind of like the accused defending himself in the court of law. He's got what for an attorney? When the self decides that you should follow the self, it's like the ego saying, follow me. That's the problem. And yet, you have to trust that what you follow is the way. And you have to surrender in order to follow the way. So what are some of the things you have to surrender in order to follow? What?
Doubt.
Doubt. Doubt's one of the things you have to surrender.
Fear.
Fear is a big one. You have to surrender fear.
Control.
Control, another one.
Desires.
Desires. All kinds of desires for all kinds of other things that may not bring you to the way.
Certainty.
Certainty, that's right. You have to surrender certainty. Yeah.
My attachment to what it should look like.
All right. Very good. Attachment to what it should look like. Well, you're a pretty important voice. So, let's sit as the follower of the way, and I want you to see what it feels like to only follow, not have to seek, not have to search, not have to find, not have to be, that your only job is just to follow the way. All right, what's it like?
Freedom.
Freedom, relief.
Sinking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. A sinking into it?
Sinking.
Mm-hmm.
It's easy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's easy. Yeah.
It reveals itself.
Good. All right, now I would like to speak to another voice, and I'm going to ask you to sit up right when I ask, not now. I'd like to speak to the way. I'd like to speak to the way, please, and just sit up straight. All right, you are?
The way.
All right, now let's just sit as the way. See what it's like to be the way. Who are you?
The way.
All right. Let's just sit. What do you notice being the way?
Tao.
Tao. Being the Tao.
It's very still.
Uh-huh, very still.
So there's nothing to do.
Isn't that interesting? There's nothing that you have to do. There's nothing to do.
Just beingness. Just beingness.
Just beingness. Yeah. Where are you?
Everywhere.
And?
Space. Right now.
Know it.
Formless.
I'm in my body.
Home? Home. So tell me more what it is like to be the way.
Full and empty.
Full and empty. Quiet.
Vast.
Vast, uh-huh.
Everything fits.
Everything just fits perfectly, doesn't it?
Other voices are gone.
Other voices are gone, aren't they?
All that is.
All that is.
So
Clear.
Open play field.
Time and distance disappear.
Time and distance. Time and space disappear.
Infinite and eternal?
Yes. Infinite and eternal. You are what the seeking mind has been seeking, right? The follower has been following. You are the way. I would like to ask the way to slowly just stand up. To slowly stand up, not to trip. And I'd like to ask the way to make a 360 degree turn. And I'd like to ask the way to be seated again. And who are you?
Way.
Now, did that get in any way diminished by standing up and turning around?
No.
Are you restricted to sitting still?
No.
Or to a particular posture?
No.
Isn't that beautiful? You're free. Long last. So tell me what is coming up for you right now as the way. Share it with us.
It's a sense of clarity.
Sense of clarity, yes.
Peace.
Peace, yeah.
Gratitude.
Gratitude. Tell me more.
I don't know if there's words for it. It's just there's this welcoming of everything and thanks.
And thanks. That's what comes up as the way. Tremendous gratitude and appreciation. Yeah, peace. Yeah.
Freedom to have this consciousness every moment of the day, no matter what I'm doing.
That is right. To have this consciousness every moment of the day, no matter what's going on.
Compassion.
Compassion, yes. Real compassion. Tell me more about this compassion.
I can embrace everything. Everyone and understand.
I can embrace everyone and everything, you said? Yeah. And understand.
I'm always available.
Yes. Always accessible and available.
No judgment.
No judgment.
I can embrace myself.
That's right. You can embrace the self, myself. Tell me more about you.
Boundless.
Boundless.
Awake.
Awake. That's what Buddha said. You know, they asked Buddha, who are you? He said, wrong question. It's not who am I, it's what am I? So they said, okay, then what are you? He said, awake. Awake. It's not a matter of who, it's what.
Totally present in the moment.
Totally present and?
In the moment.
In the moment, that's right. Totally present and in the moment. Now, how much concentration are you having to put out to be, it's effortless?
None.
None. It's effortless. What's all this efforting all about? Seeking. Seeking. Go ahead.
I'm obvious.
Yes, you are. Absolutely obvious. So why has the self had so much trouble finding you?
Because it doesn't know I am that.
It doesn't know that I am that, okay. There's another problem here. Yeah.
Well, I have to keep all those other voices employed.
You do, and one of them is the one that seeks and tries to find you. And as long as it's seeking and trying to find, guess what? It misses you. even though you're right here, ever present, available, and obvious. Yeah.
And perfect.
And absolutely perfect. That's right. Absolutely perfect. Is everybody with me? 100%? All right, I'm going to now give you some other names. They're all you, okay? These are all you. There's nothing that isn't you, okay? But each one's going to kind of help us clarify certain things. So the first one I would like to speak to is big mind, please, big mind. All right, you are?
Big mind.
All right, I want you to look and see how big you are. And take your time and try to investigate and see if you can find any boundary or limit or parameter of any sort. Okay, what do you discover?
I discover two things. One is the skeptic comes in a little bit, but then I can allow it to stay going. And the other is there's no limit that I can sense at all. On the other hand, kind of like gravity, I'm being pulled back to the body occasionally. I notice the body's there, although I can't tell where the limits are, even of the body. Okay. But it's kind of pulling me like gravity to some extent.
Okay, good. As big mind, what is it that you're seeing? As we dialogue, yeah.
As big mind, I know that there are thoughts arising. That's sufficient for me.
Okay, so you're not feeling limited by the fact that...
I feel no limits.
Okay. Anybody else? What? Yeah.
Atman and Brahman.
Atman or Brahman, okay.
I'm feeling everyone is there with me and a thought brings them.
Now, this everyone that we're talking about, who are they?
Me.
Yeah. I want to make sure everybody's getting this. So those that we're talking about are all who?
Me,
big mind. Big mind or me, right? Okay. Is there anything that is not you? So limits are... Also me. You see that? Delusion is?
Me.
Realization is?
Me.
Confusion is?
Me.
Suffering is?
Me.
Wanting is?
Me.
Hoping is?
Me.
All right, as big mind, do you have a beginning?
No.
No.
No. A birth? An end?
No.
What are you laughing?
It's cool, I can see that without the intellect.
Yeah. Yeah. No beginning, no end. You are birthless and therefore?
Deathless.
Deathless. You are unborn and therefore?
Undying.
Undying.
Eternal.
Eternal. So, as big mind, is there anything that you fear?
No.
No.
No. No. Yeah.
I don't have any sense of how I'm different from the way.
You're not. As I said, I'm going to talk to other voices that are the way, but to give you some different experiences, okay? All these voices from the way on are now transcendent voices. So, now as big mind, I want you to look at the self and tell me what you see.
Nothing.
All right. Nothing.
No.
What else? Anybody else? What do you see when you look?
Part of me.
A part of me, or a manifestation of me, a part of me. Yes.
A mental construct.
Okay, a mental construct. Yeah.
Tightening or contraction in the spine.
All right. So the self is a contraction in the spine of me. What else do you see as when you look at the self?
Like all these other human manifestations of me, it's pretty funny.
It is. It's pretty funny. Yeah. Yeah.
It's an expression of.
All right. Another way to say it, it's all an expression of me. Yes.
All of me.
It's all of me. Okay? It's all me.
All the time.
All the time. Would the self like to claim you as its own? You get that? Mm-hmm. Would the self like to attach to the idea that it's you?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What would that create?
Another mess.
What?
Another mess.
Another mess. A what?
A limit.
A limit.
Why a limit?
Why a limit? Answer him, why a limit?
Because the self is finite and big mind is infinite and the finite can't grasp the infinite. In my opinion.
Because the self is a part of big mind.
The self, by definition, is limited. Are you?
No. But that's what I need to know of myself. I need to limit myself in order to know of myself.
Okay. So in order to know yourself, you need to limit yourself, therefore, the self.
Right.
All right. I'd like now, well, let me ask you one more question. Is there anything that you, as Big Mind, are lacking?
No.
No. All right. So I'd like now to speak to another voice. I'd like to speak now to Big Heart. Big Heart. All right, you are?
Big Heart.
Big Heart. Let's sit as Big Heart and see how you are the same and yet different from Big Mind. Okay, how are you the same?
Limitless.
Limitless. Boundless. How are you different?
Instead of an emptiness, I feel love.
All right. Instead of emptiness, you experience love.
I embrace everything.
I embrace everything. But you embrace everything in a way that's more?
Embodied.
Embodied. Compassionate. Mm-hmm. Feeling?
Feeling warm.
But not clinging.
But not clinging. So when I asked Big Mind if it was lacking anything, it said no. What was it lacking?
Heart.
How come it didn't notice that?
It wasn't lacking it.
Because it wasn't lacking it. Because it embraces what? Big heart. And yet, you feel, and you care, and you have compassion. For what?
Everything.
Everything. So tell me more about you as Big Heart. Yeah.
I'm a lot juicier than Big Mind.
All right, juicier. It's a good way to put it.
I feel movement. I feel movement out from the center toward everything, and I also feel from out back in, kind of embracing, encompassing, enclosing, kind of the motherhood, the mother feeling.
Okay, good.
I'm dent free.
Dent free? Okay. Tell me more about you as Big Heart.
Unconditional, accepting.
Yes. unconditional accepting, an unconditional love. What do you see that you try to take care of? What was it?
The self.
The self?
Everything.
And everything. What are you drawn to alleviating?
Suffering.
Pain and suffering.
Contraction.
And contraction. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What is your mission as Big Heart in this world?
To love.
To love? How?
Beautifully.
What?
Beautifully.
Beautifully and? Unconditionally.
I want to bond with everything.
That's right. Bond with everything.
Liberate others.
So you're the basis of the Bodhisattva vow, the vow to liberate all beings. All right. I'd like now just to talk to one side of you, the yin, the feminine aspect of you. All right, so I'd like to speak to the feminine or yin aspect of Big Heart. Okay, you are?
Yin.
Yin aspect. Let's call you yin compassion. Yin compassion. All right, I want you to see who you are, feel who you are, experience who you are as feminine yin compassion. You embrace everything. That's right.
All is well and all manner of things shall be well.
Okay, all is well and all manners of things shall be well. That's right.
Embrace equally with equanimity.
Okay, you embrace everything equally with equanimity.
There's a limit on that as I see it. As I was thinking, this may sound funny, but I was thinking about a woman that I'm attracted to, and I don't, in from this voice, I'm not any more attracted to her than to anything else.
Len isn't. Well, no. Len's attracted to her.
Len's attracted to her,
right,
more than
you.
Other things, but me as the yin heart and compassion, she's just one of everything that's
right.
To be loved and
that's right.
Treasured.
That's right. Now, can you embrace the fact that in Len's attraction and love, it might be more towards one individual, and you embrace everyone equally?
It'll be interesting to try to live that one.
Yeah,
I can understand that.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting.
Yeah, let's see how we do. You have to email me. All right, what I want you to do as yin compassion is I want you to do what you do best with the damaged self. Whatever that is that you do best, embrace, hold, love, unconditional, whatever it is, I want you to do that right now with the damaged self. Only you can do this for the damaged self. So what are you doing, or what did you do? Yeah.
Love and heal.
Loved and healed?
Mm-hmm. Healed. Nurtured. In abstract, infinite way.
Uh-huh. Good. And what was?
Healed.
Mm-hmm.
I'm beginning to let it be itself.
Yeah.
I'm only able to begin that. I started wanting to heal and change it.
Yeah, but you just
realized I need to let it go and...
Just let it be.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a beautiful way that you can express your yin compassion, is letting it be. Yeah.
Telling it everything will be okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Add the image of holding it.
Yeah.
But not trying to say you're not going to be a damaged self.
Right, right. You're not trying to fix it or change it. You're just holding it, embracing it. That damaged self has been looking for this where?
Everywhere.
Everywhere. And
that's
is it and isn't it true that you're the one who can offer it? All right, now I'd like to speak to the young compassion, young big heart, to the masculine big heart. All right, you are?
Young compassion.
Tell me about you.
I'm decisive.
Yes, very decisive.
I clarify.
Clarify. You made the gesture of cut. You do. You cut. Yeah.
Manifest.
You manifest, yeah.
I'm ruthless.
Yes, you can be ruthless when? When?
When needed.
When needed. That's right. When necessary, you are, can be ruthless.
Tough love.
Tough love, yeah.
Bring courage, yes.
Yes, encouraging. Yeah.
Bring courage.
Bring courage. That's right. You offer other things too. What else do you offer?
Loving strength.
Loving strength.
Powerful.
Power. Powerful. What else?
Direction.
Direction. Something the self often lacks. When it comes to not overeating, not overdrinking, what?
Discipline.
Discipline. You are the one who can offer discipline when appropriate. Discipline. All right, I want you to take now the self, not the damaged self, but the self, and offer it what only you can offer it. Tough love, discipline, whatever it is, ruthlessness. Because every self needs you. Okay, what did you offer it, or what are you offering it?
Confidence.
Confidence?
Mm-hmm.
Anything else? Yeah.
Power to be.
Power to be.
Free of damage.
Free of damage, good.
Sense of certainty.
Okay. All right, now would you allow me to speak to integrated compassion, integrated big heart. Yin-yang, big heart. Okay, you are?
Integrated
compassion. Yin-yang, big heart. So tell me about you. How do you function? When? Where?
With wisdom.
With wisdom. Excellent.
I want to love everyone in such a way as to help them gain this sort of thing.
Good.
Bodhisattva.
Good, as a bodhisattva.
Direction with the compassion.
Good. Yes. Balance.
Harmony and balance.
Yes, harmony, balance, yeah.
Fight for my compassion.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You'll fight for compassion. Yeah.
With grace.
With grace.
Flexibility to be.
Flexibility to be.
Either way.
Either way. Either yin or yang compassion.
I can give what is needed when it's needed.
That's right. That's what I wanted to hear. I can give what is needed when it's needed, appropriately. See? You respond to the situation with compassion. It might be strong masculine compassion. It might be yin feminine compassion. But you respond to the situation and you'll mix it up. You're very flexible that way. All right. I'd like now to speak to the master. The master. The boss. Who am I speaking to?
My master.
All right, who do they all work for?
Me.
All right. You remember the controller didn't know who he worked for. In fact, the controller thought what?
He thinks
he's the boss. All right, now, whose company is this?
Mine.
Whose firm?
Mine.
Whose ship?
Mine.
Whose orchestra?
Mine.
Whose home?
Mine.
Yeah. So, who's responsible?
I am.
Me. That's right, I am. Who's there to blame?
Me.
No one else. But you don't even need to blame, you just take responsibility. So tell me more about you as the master. Are you home?
Always.
Are you awake? Don't be deceived by any of these guys. Now or in the future. So what is it like as the master?
Powerful, clear.
Powerful, clear.
Clarity.
Clarity.
Full of choice.
Full of choice, that's right. Wise choices.
Exciting.
Exciting.
Loving.
What was it?
Loving.
Loving. Anybody else?
Adaptive. Adaptive.
Adaptive, yes. All right. Let me now speak. It's another voice. It's really like you, except I don't want to send you folks home as the master. Particularly you men. Because you're going to learn the hard way who the real master is. All right? So I'm going to give you another voice that you take home with you. Same voice, just another name. I want to talk or speak to the integrated, free-functioning human being. Integrated, free-functioning human being. You are?
Integrated, free-functioning human being.
So first of all, you are what?
Integrated.
Integrated. Integrated. And you function how?
Freely.
Yeah. As?
A human being.
As a human being. What is it like as the integrated, free-functioning human being?
I accept my reality.
Okay, I accept my reality.
It's fun.
It's fun.
It feels good.
It feels good.
No more gender-biased names.
No more gender-biased names. Was that the master? You know, when the master speaks, it doesn't need to speak as a gender-biased name. And you men, if you try to take that master home as a gender-biased thing, you're going to find out. Don't do it. I made that mistake. All right, thank you.